But
yeah, hi, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this EPC policy dialogue, which is going to be looking at the transatlantic and Russian responses to the crisis in Belarus. What next? As I think we're all aware, Belarus has been in a crisis since August 2020, following rigged elections. Protesters have been in the streets ever since. The protesters have demanded an end at the 26-year reign of Alexander Lukashenko, and that elections, future elections, must be monitored by the international community. Unfortunately, this has not happened. Rather, as reported by Human Rights Watch and many of our human rights organizations, there's been a brutal crackdown on protesters, which has left a number of them dead. There's also been widespread reports of torture and other human rights abuses. Since the protests first began, I think something like 35,000 people have been detained by the Belarusian police and other law enforcement agencies. But yet, you know, these protesters, these individuals, the Belarusians, you know, they're a brave set, and the struggle for freedom and democracy continues to go on and on. I mean, Lukashenko continues to cling on to power, and Moscow is helping him despite the fact that President Putin is reportedly not a great fan of Mr. Lukashenko. I'm guessing the idea of having a democratic leader in Minsk is apparently not on President Putin's bucket list. And Lukashenko has been bolstered a lot by the support that he has received from the Kremlin so far. Apart from finance, this has obviously been vis-a-vis a mass disinformation campaign, which is spread throughout the country. The cost of this seems to be that Belarus will become much more strongly linked to Russia. And in this case, it clearly ends, you know, the long-held policy of balancing between the West and Russia that President Lukashenko has been carrying out for many decades. I mean, this can have serious implications for Belarus. And what happens in Belarus is crucial for the EU, as it has regional implications, particularly in security terms. I mean, for example, we're talking about NATO's eastern flank. So there's many reasons to be concerned there. The main response so far from the West, the EU and the US, has been sanctions, along with support for the Belarusian people. I mean, the EU initiated its EU for Belarus initiative a few months ago, and this offers solidarity with the people of Belarus, and it focuses on civil society, media, youth, SMEs, and health. But I would say as well that unfortunately today, Belarus doesn't seem to be either at the top of the EU's or Washington's priority list. I mean, other events have taken place. International relations always moves on, whether it's, you know, the problems with the Chinese, or more recently related to Russia's huge escalation on Ukraine's border. But it's crucially important that Belarus remains high on the transatlantic agenda. You know, people in the country are continuing to face this brutal crackdown. They need ongoing support, so it should stay there. Now, today we're going to be analyzing the situation in the country. What can we expect next, and the response from the transatlantic community, as well as from Russia. And I'm very pleased that I have four guests with me today who are great experts on Belarus, much bigger experts than I am, who I'm going to introduce now. First of all, we have Kataryna Wolczuk, who's a professor of East European politics at the Center for Russian, European and Eurasian Studies at the University of Birmingham in the UK. Melinda Haring, who's deputy director of the Eurasia Center at the Atlantic Council. Stanislav Byshok, who is executive director of the international monitoring organization CIS-EMO in Moscow. And last but not least, Yauheni Preiherman, founder and director of Minsk Dialogue Council on International Relations, and he is based in Minsk. To the audience, thank you for joining us today. You can put your questions either by clicking on the hand icon or by typing in the Q&A box. And I would ask you to start to do that, you know, quite early on, so I can even start to put your questions as we go along. I'm going to start by asking all of our panelists to give a sort of brief few minutes intervention or comments on how they see the current situation in Belarus today. And then I'm going to ask all of them a few questions before turning over to the audience. So I would like to start with you, Yauheni, as you're coming from Belarus.
Hello, and thank you very much for the invitation, for having me. It's a great pleasure and honor. Let me begin with the internal dimension. Just a couple of words. I think all of us are following the developments, and we see that the head-on confrontation between the Lukashenko government and the protesters has now led to a situation where physically the protest has been, well, perhaps not defeated, but at least we no longer see any massive manifestations of the protests which we observed after August for a couple of months last year. And this is something which was easy to expect and to predict, because when a leaderless protest, which really has this problem of leadership vacuum, faces directly head on the consolidated authoritarian regime, which is supported clearly by the key regional actor, Russia, the chances for this leaderless protest to score victories is really small, especially given that the people on the protest side who claim leadership have made what I think some mistakes in these recent months. And of course, we can discuss those mistakes in more detail later on, but I think we, as of now, we can clearly see that physically the protest has been minimized, and the government has concluded in some respects that it has prevailed. That's why it is very clearly now trying to enforce on the rest of society its own agenda, and it is doing it in a completely non-compromised way, which has always been typical of the Lukashenko authoritarian regime. But I think because of the head-on collision and confrontation that started last year, it has turned even less compromising, because it has concluded that it has celebrated a victory in this clash. It is going to continue like this. And that is why all those claims and all attempts to force the Lukashenko government into some kind of national dialogue with those leaders of the protests, who are now mainly either behind bars or in Warsaw and Vilnius. So those attempts are not really likely at all to succeed. And I think what we've observed in recent months clearly points to that. I will be happy to answer the questions about the internal situation in further detail, because I think quite a few interesting developments are taking place. But let me now turn quickly to the international dimension. So quite clearly, as Amanda noted in her introductory remarks, the relationship with the West has been ruined. And that means that indeed the Lukashenko regime is not really capable for the time being to return to any kind of a balancing act which it practiced in previous years, and specifically, emphatically so, in the last 5-6 years, especially after the crisis in and around Ukraine broke out and Minsk took this situational neutral position on the conflict between Russia and Ukraine and was promoting what I call a bridging agenda in regional affairs and regional security. So this has obviously become problematic, because the West, and by the West, I mean, of course, the EU and the United States and some other countries, did not recognize Lukashenko as the legitimate leader. In this respect, of course, the weight of Moscow has grown even further. Moscow has always been a central actor for Belarusian politics, but in the context of the crisis, it became simply the ultimate kingmaker. For its own reasons, and again, we'll probably discuss it in more detail, but for its own reasons, Moscow has decided without much doubt to support Lukashenko, even though it is also true, like Amanda said, that Lukashenko is now not particularly popular in different decision-making circles in Moscow. But then out of its own strategic reasons, Putin made this decision. And there is no ground to expect that the decision is going to be changed. Because again, I just want to reemphasize this, the support of Lukashenko on Putin's side has to do mainly with how Putin himself sees Russia's strategic interest and what things in terms of bigger geopolitics and regional geopolitics he wants to prevent. And here Lukashenko has always been a master of this game. I even call him the best Kremlinologist in the world. So he certainly knows how to deal and manipulate with those things. And he has made sure that this internal conflict in Belarus was positioned as a Russia-West conflict or part of this Russia-West conflict. So in this way, he ensures the continued support of the Russians. At the same time, and I'm aware of the little time I have, at the same time, I want to make a point which I'm sure will cause a lot of, well, debate and disagreement, but I think it's important to start discussing it right now. If we'll look at the whole situation from a strategic point of view, and that is to say more geopolitically, I would rather contradict Amanda's words a little bit when she said that the balancing act which Lukashenko practiced all these years is no longer possible. Because essentially, when we look at the regional map, and especially from the security point of view, strategic changes have not yet taken place. And in this respect, there are still ways how Lukashenko, even not being recognized by the West as the legitimate president of Belarus, can still restore those elements of this balancing act practice, or the hedging policy, which I tend to call it. First of all, because it is in the utmost and ultimate interest of Belarus itself. And even in this highly difficult situation where Moscow is the only game in town again, it still will strive to keep as much room for maneuver for itself as possible. And of course, relations with the West are crucial here, even though there are some other actors on whom Lukashenko wants and intends to rely. But he will try to preserve, as I said, at least some elements of this hedging portfolio he exercised and perfected in many respects in the previous 5-6 years. On the Western side, again, of course, what has happened is a game changer, and Lukashenko is seen as non-acceptable completely by many capitals in the West. But at the same time, the strategic security interests remain the same. And since Belarus, at least on the level of rhetoric and declarations, it wants to continue at least some elements of its previous security policy, I think ultimately there might be some arrangements, which, as I said, might return a few elements of the previous relations between Belarus and the West. But of course, without illusions, even though I would claim that there were not too many illusions in the past several years, but still today, illusions are zero. And I think I'll stop at this, even though there is really a lot to add.
Okay, thank you, Yauheni. It's true. I will come back to you shortly with many questions because you raised quite a lot of issues that need to be further elaborated on. But I would like to turn the floor now to Kataryna Wolczuk to ask you, you know, Kataryna, do you see this the picture the same way as Yauheni? He seems to be, you know, giving the message that Lukashenko isn't going anywhere. The protests have failed. There's going to be no democracy in Belarus, and this is it. Do you see it like this, or do you see it different? And could you also elaborate a bit on or evaluate how you've seen the response and the approach from the EU so far?
Thank you very much, Amanda, for an invitation to disagree or challenge what's been said so far. And to be honest, my interpretation, and Yauheni may come back later, is not that protests have failed and there's not going to be democracy. It's a long haul, it's a marathon, but in the long term, it's difficult to see how the regime can persist. It may be a long time, it may be talking about a decade even or so, but ultimately Lukashenko's days will be over. And what we've seen, I think from the European perspective, the key question is for us, because Belarus has been depicted as a problem for a long time. So the question for us is it more of a continuity, it's more of the same, or have we seen a dramatic sort of step change? And I have to say, from my perspective, in terms of this unprecedented mass mobilization, when for three decades we are used to talk about Belarusians as rather sort of passive and acquiesce with the political regime, this is a massive step change. And in response to this, this transitioning of the regime from soft authoritarianism to basically ruling by force in tandem of Lukashenko and Siloviki, power agencies from Belarus. So the regime by now relies on violence and intimidation. And this means it has lost legitimacy. It's not perceived basically as legitimate by the people. And given this scale of repressions, which has touched on so many Belarusians, it's really difficult to see basically how the regime can ever be perceived as worth having negotiations with, and how it could make some kind of transition arrange. So what we have is this, actually, not that the protests failed, but they were needed, they were necessary, but they were never sufficient. They would never be sufficient as such. But what we've seen from a long-term point of view, this really unprecedented awakening of the younger generation and older, basically intergenerational consensus. This is very, very important because it doesn't go away. So it's going to stay. Is the question is, to what extent? For example, we've been cheering and, you know, peaceful protesters. From me, when confronted with that kind of leader and regime, how ethical it is to actually basically encourage people to engage in peaceful protests, which actually mean oppression. We need a much more diversified strategy to support the people, to make sure not only that they show courage, bravery, and citizenship, but they're actually supported when it comes to consequences. And so from that point of view, there is no quick fix solution, but it doesn't mean that because there are no protests, there is no prospect for change and no need for action. And this brings me to the sort of EU dimension. What we've seen, the responses are all very necessary, not recognizing the election sanctions, words of concern and condemnation, they're all necessary and yet vastly inefficient because they are so limited and so delayed. And what is puzzling, and perhaps this is a collective sort of head scratching session, why the sanctions are so weak in comparison even to what we saw a decade ago, when we had officially six political prisoners and about 180 people on the sanction list. Now, the proportions are vastly different and we have less than 100 people and seven entities. So what we've seen is a limited, lukewarm support. And the EU, despite a lot of effort from NGOs and some member states, especially Lithuania, we haven't seen, and Poland as well. And I have to say, as someone who comes from Poland, although I disagree on so many things with the Polish government, on the issue of Belarus, they are on the right side of the argument. So from that point of view, it has been Lithuania. And what we've seen is this fragmentation and sort of, and the lack of sort of almost sort of live to have a will to have foreign policy in the EU. I'm going to be quite provocative because I think Belarus is not even about democracy promotion. It is about the red line, democracy defense. So from that point of view, we really have to consider the reputational and long-term implications of this rather sort of inactive, so inert approach for the EU's standing, not only in the Eastern neighborhood, but in the world in general. So I will finish on this note. Thank you.
Thank you, Kataryna, and I'll come back to you again shortly. I'd like to give the floor now to Melinda to hear the perspective on the situation from the United States. I mean, I know the Atlantic Council has been very active on Belarus. I mean, you have numerous very great publications giving good advice on what needs to be done. So it'd be interesting to hear your insights.
Thank you. Thank you, Amanda. It's always a joy to be with you. It's great to meet you and share a panel with you all this morning or afternoon. So as Amanda mentioned, the Atlantic Council has put out a paper, and I'll drop the link for everyone. It's called Biden and Belarus, A Strategy for the New Administration. We put this out in January, and it's now May. So it's a couple of months old. Unfortunately, the new administration has done a lot of things right in its foreign policy moves. But in my view, they have not given Belarus enough attention. Now, I don't want to completely criticize them, because we do have a new US ambassador there. Julie Fisher is fabulous. She's been on the ground. She's been visible. I think she's making all the right moves. I take Katerina's point, though, that sanctions have not been strong enough, and they haven't changed behavior. And that's what we're trying to do here. So I have 5 points. First point, I strongly agree with Kataryna. Belarus has forever changed. If you're asking me to put on my analyst hat, is this the end of Lukashenko? Yes. We don't know how long it's going to take. I agree that he's no longer legitimate. This particular protest movement may not be successful. I think the number of people in the streets is pretty depressing. You know, it's very, very small. We expected after the winter holidays, large, vigorous protests, and they're pretty small, I'm not going to lie. But I think the bigger point, though, is Lukashenko is done. It's a question of how the Belarusian people get rid of him. And I think one of the most interesting things is there weren't enough splits in the security services. This is something that we were all watching along. There were splits in the police forces, but it was never enough. I disagree with Yevgen that it was inevitable that this protest would fail because it was leadership or faceless. It was not leadershipless or faceless. Yes, at the beginning, that's a valid point. But eventually, Tikhanovskaya and her group stood up, and the movement does have a face. It very much has a face. It has demands. It's organized. It's in multiple cities. I don't accept that argument. And then the fifth point, if you want to summarize, what are US interests and what does Biden need to do in Belarus? So Biden's dilemma is how to encourage and strengthen the opposition without sparking and permitting a successful Kremlin crackdown. And so the US needs to figure out how to keep encouraging Tikhanovskaya and the people of Belarus without doing too much. And it's very delicate. And I'm not going to pretend I don't know what that balance is. I'm glad I don't work at the State Department, but we put together a list of recommendations on things that the US can be doing. And I share Katerina's view that we need to step up sanctions. We have great experts on this at the Atlantic Council. I'm not a sanctions expert, and I'm not going to pretend to be, but she's right that the sanctions have not stung enough. Thank you for the opportunity to be here.
Thank you, Melinda. Now, finally, Stanislav. Perhaps I could, you know, frame the question slightly differently. Perhaps you could elaborate a bit on, you know, what are the drivers and goals of Russian policy towards Belarus these days? I mean, what does the Kremlin want, you know, as the final outcome? I mean, there's been a lot of talk about, you know, soft annexation. Would that be the right term? Or is it something else? I mean, what's on the Kremlin's mind?
Thank you, Amanda, for giving me this opportunity to speak about what's on the Kremlin's mind. I don't know, frankly, but what I know is that, this idea that one day or another Lukashenko will like go away, it's hard to disagree with this argument, but it can be applied to any leader, be it a democratic leader or an authoritarian leader. So it's not the answer to the question of our time. Indeed, the Lukashenko regime turned out to be more resilient than many expected, especially at the height of the 2020 protests in August and in September. And of course, Russia's position in this conflict was and is quite predictable, actually. because I think it's fair to say that security is the Russian Federation's middle name. So the Russian Federation perceives what happens in Belarus or what happened in Ukraine in 2014 or what happened in Georgia previously as a security challenge. A security challenge not by diverse states or civil societies of these states, but a security challenge based on a global Western master plan to encroach Russia or to put a cordon sanitaire on its like Western and Southern borders and so as to isolate Russia from the West. So in this mindset, there are no free and independent people or civil society organizations or like movements in Belarus or elsewhere. Everything what happens, especially if it has to do with mass protests, is orchestrated by outside powers or by some fifth columns inside these countries. And the Belarusian case is not an exception. If you turn on Russian TV, the official like channels, state affiliated channels, and the talk show, political talk shows, there you'll find this idea reiterated time and time again that nobody cares how many votes did Lukashenko really get last year, or how many votes did Tikhanovskaya get. Doesn't matter. What matters is the master plan. And these people who take part in the protests, maybe they are good people, but the majority have been deceived by the puppeteers from Western affiliated organizations, so from the West, from Poland, from Lithuania and elsewhere, who want to topple the legitimate government so as to make or to turn Belarus against Russia, to make it to make it not Russia's ally, but Russia's like enemy, as today's Ukraine. So in this case, some political scientists, some commentators said that maybe at the height of the protests, Moscow could be more flexible in dealing with Belarusian civil society. Maybe invite some to Moscow, maybe to arrange some round tables, like to hear from themselves, from the Belarusian people, from the opposition leaders, what they really want, what's their position on the relations with Russia, on the union state between Russia and Belarus, et cetera, et cetera. But no, it was not the case, because all them are perceived as like tools of the West. And so the swift acceptance by Moscow of Lukashenko as a legitimate leader was, of course, as Yauheni and others rightly stated, not out of admiration towards Lukashenko. Lukashenko is not popular in Moscow, and he hasn't been popular like for years now. But there is no plan B, and there is no like second guy to put the bet on this second guy, because in the Kremlin, people believe that yes, Lukashenko is not a perfect ally. He's a bad ally maybe, but those who are against him are worse because they are pro-Western. The paradox of the situation is that despite the fact that for the West, for the global West, Lukashenko is a toxic person, right? But at the same time, he is quite tolerable just because he still maintains a lot of independence in his talks, in his relations vis-a-vis Moscow. He doesn't want more Russian troops permanently stationed in Belarus. And in this case, well, for NATO and for the transatlantic countries, I mean, he's quite acceptable in this role of a person who doesn't make Belarus part of Russia, who doesn't want to surrender Belarus, the Russian independence to Russia. And for Russia, at the same time, yes, Russia is quite unhappy with Lukashenko because he's not a pleasant partner in negotiations, as long as I can tell. But at the same time, he is the person who will never accept Western NATO troops stationed in Belarus. So in this case, for the time being, and this time being can be, well, years ahead, it's a paradox, but for Russia and for the West, Lukashenko remains an acceptable figure. That's my point.
Thank you, Stanislav. I'll come back to you again shortly, but I would like to turn back now to Yauheni. First of all, I would like you to elaborate a bit on the key or the most important internal developments that have taken place and what do they mean for the country? And secondly, you know, what is the feeling among the, you know, the general population of Belarus these days? I mean, does the population just feel, you know, worn out with this several months of protests and the ongoing crisis, or something else? I mean, how is the support among the population now for Lukashenko or for the other opposition figures?
Thank you, Amanda. Let me begin with the second question. Well, you know, it's very difficult to talk about how society in Belarus feels for the very simple reason we don't really have proper public opinion surveys. A couple of years ago, the last reputable pollster was banned. And ever since, we do get some sporadic research from time to time done. In recent months, a couple of online-based surveys were conducted, and you never know, due to the methodological limitations, how to treat those, even though we do get some information. But I think, you know, the most important things we can basically generalize. And we can see that there was an unprecedented outburst of protest and energy last year. We all understand that had never happened before in Belarusian history. This is unprecedented. And of course, they were driven for a couple of months by this hope that because so many people are now demonstrating their dissatisfaction with the regime and especially with the methods that the regime uses, that it will ultimately lead to the regime's collapse. And especially those assumptions were widespread in August and September, and some of the commentators, which are usually regarded highly, clearly got the situation wrong and started predicting that the regime would fall down very quickly. And this is what people, you know, thought, what drove them. And now, 7-8 months later, when we get a typical situation of counter-revolution, which you find more or less everywhere where a revolution has failed, what you see is unfortunately predominant depression across many segments of society. And here I need to get back to this point about the leadership, protests, where we seem to disagree with Amanda. I think, unfortunately, we still continue to see complete leadership vacuum. And this is exactly one of the reasons for this depression in society, because people were told, I mean, the general public who were protesting were told by those people who wanted to become leaders. Back in August, September, and October, they were told that the Lukashenko regime would fall down by the end of the year and that Tikhanovskaya and her team would arrive and start managing the transition. Then they were told, actually, that for some miraculous reason, the authoritarian regime, which has done everything possible to basically, you know, silence the protests by force, is going to enter into some kind of negotiation with the Tikhanovskaya team. And people were told it would somehow miraculously happen in May. Of course, when they see this, they conclude not only that the protest is leaderless and they cannot rely on those people, but they also conclude that perhaps those people are living in a separate reality. If they continue making those public statements about the inevitability of soon entering into negotiation or regime falling down, and nothing on the ground here in Belarus indicates that. Unfortunately, if anything, the developments on the ground indicate a very opposite development. And that's why, as I said, we do observe, unfortunately, this spreading depression. This is not the end of the story, and don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that, you know, the regime has prevailed and we are getting back to square one where we began from. This has been a qualitative change in Belarusian politics and society. And that leads me to the first question, I'll try to be short on this, about the key internal developments. I agree with what I think Kataryna said, that this qualitative change has happened and Belarus is not going to be the same again. The problem which I've always had with this argument, even before the crisis broke out, is that unfortunately, Belarus is a country which, you know, to put it a little bit simplistically, it does sit between Russia and the West. And historically, culturally, those differences have always been ingrained into the body of society. So the only way for Belarus to succeed as a sovereign state is to make sure that those two parts of society, those leaning towards Russia and those leaning towards the West, and then the core, which is leaning towards the national interests of Belarus, find a common language and a common ground. This is the only way for the country to succeed, if anything, because of those tremendous external structural pressures on the country. Unfortunately, because the revolution did not succeed, and we're now living through a counter-revolution, the body of this country is being torn apart. And even with the enormous amount of people who are against Lukashenko, Lukashenko is staying in power, and it means that the divide is growing. And that means that, unfortunately, the country is in big trouble. It is as vulnerable to any external potential influence as never before. And the room for maneuvering, be it Lukashenko at the helm of this country or anyone else succeeding him before too long, the room for maneuver is minuscule. And again, I'm just very worried about these structural developments. I'll stop with this.
To remember to unmute myself. Could this have, you know, the add-on repercussion of, you know, greater outflows of Belarusians from Belarus? I mean, we've seen already an increase, I think, of people leaving the country. Is this likely to, you know, continue and pick up speed? I mean, this would have a huge impact as well on the future of the country, especially, you know, a brain drain and all that.
It's for me, right? Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, obviously, one of the consequences of this is that the best people are leaving. You know, only a couple of years ago, people saw a very different development on the ground, and you know, they were still dissatisfied with a lot of things, but at least they saw some progress, even, you know, in cultural life, in economic life. In public life, you know, recent years have seen quite some positive developments in terms of the civil society development. And I would even argue this is one of the reasons why that unprecedented outbreak of protest energy was possible last year. And of course, people were looking ahead. So they were looking forward to continuing their lives and building their careers in Belarus. But now that they've seen all those horrible pictures last year, and now that they understand that their hopes are not coming true and that the regime is now up to this counter-revolution, of course, a lot of people are going away. Some of them, I would even argue, are going away not because they're, you know, anti-Lukashenko. They might well be quite tolerant to Lukashenko, but they simply don't want to live in the atmosphere we have here, which is, again, a head-on collision between the two Belaruses, unfortunately. And this is another tragic side of all these developments, I would say.
Okay, thank you. I want to turn back to you now, Kataryna, and focus again on the approach of the EU. As you mentioned already, the sanctions that were placed, you know, haven't really been strong enough to have an impact. I mean, what would you recommend at this point? And I will put the same question as well to you, Melinda, what the EU and the US could do. Do we need a stronger transatlantic approach? And what would be the recipe? And, you know, what should, you know, the opposition forces be doing as well? I mean, what would be your advice to them at this point?
Thank you. Perhaps I'll start with taking some issues, something that has been mentioned both by Stanislav and Yauheni. And the issue for us is that the sanctions are necessary, but are never going to be sufficient, but we still need them. So what we need, given the complex realities on the ground, we need a really sort of multifaceted strategy. It's just not, sanctions is one of the instruments in our toolbox. It's not the all and be sort of and end all. So from that point of view, the sanctions, what it sends the signal is, you know, about this very slow, incremental, fragmented approach, which is not even as powerful as 10 years ago. That's really, we really need to know. There should be hundreds of people on the sanction list. The issue is, I will mention it now, because one of the issues that we have in the EU, including EU institutions, is that we have a massive deficit of expertise on the Eastern Partnership countries in general, but on Belarus in particular. So this, because Belarus has been stable, you know, in a negative way, we could neglect it. We just don't have this intelligence, including Lukashenko's assets in the West, Lukashenko and his cronies, loyalists in the West. There's a variety of reasons. There's a discussion about basically dirty money coming from authoritarian and corrupt regimes, and yet we have inaction. So from that point of view, we need to know much more. And I feel that of all the EU institutions, it seems at the moment, at least, it's the European Parliament which has the largest contingent of people really knowledgeable about Belarus, just because of the sheer, you know, size and expertise of MEPs. So we need more basically intelligence, more knowledge, and the parallels. How do we talk about Belarus? It would really help us to have a point of reference. Some people talk about Yugoslavia in the 1990s. We've seen this highest degree of violence since the 1990s in Yugoslavia. Some people talk about the basically pre-war, early 20th century, a very oppressive regime. Some people talk about Poland in the 1980s, when basically we had a very different, a long-term and coordinated approach from the West, and which worked, was prepared for a long-term contingency and change of basically collapse of the communist regime in Poland. So we have this situation, the sanctions are necessary, they are not sufficient, but it has to be one of many toolbox, basically instruments that we use. What is interesting about the protests, and perhaps I will position myself between Yauheni and Melinda in terms of protests. For me, it's perfectly rational for the protests to peter out. I mean, why would you suffer if by now people know they cannot change the regime by basically peaceful action? It's not going to be effective. So it's a perfectly rational response, especially when confronted with this oppression and intimidation, even for putting out clothing basically in national colors on a balcony. Having said that, protests do matter because we need them for the Western media, for keeping Belarus up. And you know, in this media-driven world, decision makers react to what's on, in the media. And from that point of view, the lack of protests in Belarus for very legitimate and strong reasons, very rational and ethical, as I would almost say, means that Belarus is seems to be off the agenda. I also would take the issue perhaps with this, I'm quite puzzled that Yauheni presented the Belarusian society as split between sort of pro-Western and pro-Russian. For me, one of the most fascinating features was, in a way, how Belarusian, how bottom-up, and how the narrative around the protests was really wrapped around the Belarusian sort of nation and identity. Who are we as a peaceful and dignified people? So this sort of pro-Western, and especially, you know, this Europeanization agenda may not be so strong, and pro-Russian, I just wonder how it captures the divisions in society. And the issue of the regime, and what we see, the same issue as in Russia. In turn, we have no Raul Castro to follow. The hollowing out and personalization of the regime means there is no plan B. So the same scenario that it's either plan A or nothing. So from that point of view, I would say that the change is going to be slow, but still it has to happen one way or another. I would just, the final issue I will take is with Stanislav's point that I very much agree, you know, the situation with Lukashenko suits the Kremlin as it is. I call it the scissors effect. The weaker the domestic regime, the stronger the role of Russia. James Scher had this sort of reliance on this weakness versus strength. Having said that, I wouldn't say that Lukashenko is acceptable to the West. You know, it's, I would not transfer this securitization agenda onto the West. Lukashenko is not acceptable, and it's regardless of any NATO troops in or outside Belarus. But still, we perhaps it's even worse because he's not acceptable, but we still don't know what to do with this dictator on the doorstep of the EU. Perhaps I will finish on this note for the time being. Thank you.
Thank you, Kataryna. I agree totally with what you said about European member states could do more about, you know, preventing finance, corrupted finance from Lukashenko and other figures in the regime. I mean, this topic always comes up whenever we're talking about any sort of sanctions, but it never gets advanced. Maybe that's because member states are more interested again in their own interests from this topic rather than putting on sanctions. But I would ask, you know, Melinda as well to elaborate a bit on what you think. I mean, how could the transatlantic agenda be boosted? What more could be done in terms of sanctions, and what more could we do to support the opposition and civil society? And what would your message be to those people in the country to try and help them, or what they could do at this point that they haven't done already?
Thanks, Amanda. Okay, I think you constructed a boring panel because Kataryna and I basically agree with each other most of the way. They're just teasing. On the dirty money point, so you asked me to address about five things, so I'll be fast. On dirty money, there's really good work that's being done on this question. It's very private, though. We can't talk about it on Zoom. We can't talk about it. You know, it needs to be done face-to-face. There's really heroic Belarusian investigative journalists who know where the dirty financial flows are. So Kataryna, give me your telephone number, give me your email address. Let's talk offline. This needs to be done correctly, but the work is being done. And I agree that it needs, if you can amplify it in the EU, that would be fantastic. You're absolutely right though, that there's a deficit of Belarus talent. In the United States, there's I think two Belarus experts in all of Washington. We set up a Belarus program last year and I had to go to Europe to find people who knew what they were talking about when we were building a program. Unfortunately, like you said, it's just been so sort of stable and boring in a bad way that people haven't been paying attention. And the politics are really interesting right now, especially from a social movement perspective. Let's see, Yevgeny, I don't think your argument makes sense. You're arguing that it's leadershipless because they made bad decisions. That one does not follow the other. There is leadership. Sure, they should. They may have made immature claims. Come out, we're going to get rid of Lukashenko within a certain period of time. They don't, you have to remember, Svetlana Tikhanovskaya was an English teacher. She's green to politics. This is her first foray into politics, and she's been thrust into a role she never wanted. That doesn't make it leadershipless. It might be immature, it might be maturing or ripening, but your characterization is flat out false. And there are not two Belaruses, there are three Belaruses. There's a group around Svetlana Tikhanovskaya, there's a group around Lukashenko, that's true. But if you look at some of the polling that's coming out, I think the most interesting article I've seen from Chatham House calls the second group or the third group the spectators. These are people who they are not talking about how they're going to vote because they're afraid. They tend to be more supportive of protests than of the regime, but they don't really like anything. And you could argue that the movement, Svetlana Tikhanovskaya and the Democratic Movement, did not appeal to the spectator group, that they didn't speak to their interests. I think that's a fair argument. And I think it's probably a result of political immaturity more than anything else, or the need to grow. Again, the democratic movement in Belarus has been under enormous strain, so I would cut them a lot of slack. What can the US do in terms of transatlantic relations? I think Kataryna had a lot of really good ideas, but I want to step back for a minute. I expected the Biden administration to really prioritize Belarus. When it looked at the former Soviet Union, where are we going to put our money, our assistance, our energy? And in January, I thought it was going to be Belarus. Ukraine did not look very promising. Ukraine has done lots of backsliding in the last year. I don't have to remind this audience how much the country has, as of March 2019, they dismissed the reform-minded government. But you know, everything changed because of the Russia escalation. There's a lot more attention on Ukraine right now. Zelensky's under enormous pressure to reform. Let's see what's gonna happen. But the point is, it's taken all the oxygen away from Belarus. So I'm really worried. I can't get anyone to pay attention to Belarus. Our events, if I look at the number of eyeballs, people who come to our Belarus events, huge numbers, huge interest in the fall, it's petered out. So I think part of it is we're just having a hard time getting people to pay attention and find the storyline compelling. And I don't say that in, I don't mean to dismiss people's concerns, because people are making enormous sacrifices to be on the streets. It's really hard to get people to pay attention to what's going on in Minsk. There's a number of things that my colleagues and I, so this paper is by Anders Oslin, John Herbst, and Sandy Birchbaugh. We have a number of ideas on what the US could do. A couple of them are increasing US assistance, especially on media support. I think that's really crucial. We have a number of suggestions on sanctions. I'm not gonna go through that because it's too technical. Some very practical things though, Amanda. Biden should designate a senior official to coordinate sanctions with the EU, the UK, and Canada. That's something very easy we could do. We also recommended that President Biden meet with Svetlana Tikhanovskaya within his first 100 days. Obviously, that didn't happen, and we're still recovering from COVID like the rest of the world, but there's no reason why he can't do it now. She just went and testified before Congress. It's time for her to come to Washington. Washington is a safe place. Almost everyone's vaccinated. I think it's time for the administration to give Belarus a lot more love. Thank you.
Yeah, I agree with you. I think it's tragic how quickly Belarus seems to have disappeared from the focus of Europe and the United States and probably elsewhere. But of course, you know, Ukraine is always the country that gets all of the attention. But I mean, it shouldn't be like that. It is like that, but I agree that there needs to be a refocus back onto Belarus. And I also agree that, you know, working with other like-minded countries, you know, Canada, the UK and whatnot, should also be encouraged. So, you know, Kataryna, maybe, you know, you're sitting in the UK, or I think you're sitting in the UK. Maybe perhaps you could enlighten us as to the what the UK has actually been doing vis-a-vis Belarus, and if it's been working together with the EU and the US. And then I'll turn back to you, Stanislav.
The UK has sanctioned, but I'm not sure to what extent it has been working with the EU. My feeling is that Belarus, as always has been when it comes to, even when the UK was inside the EU, basically the Eastern Partnership countries, including Belarus, have been always a foreign policy issue and took backseat vis-a-vis any sort of internal. And now we have, obviously, with early Brexit teething problems, this takes precedence. I am not sure. I would need to ask my colleagues in the Foreign Office to what extent there has been this cooperation. But what I would like just to emphasize the issue and take a bit of sort of disagree with perhaps with Melinda for a change on this. I don't think because we have problems in Ukraine, we should say, I mean, Ukraine, you know, whatever the state in the post-Soviet space deserves support for whatever, basically for to protect that territorial integrity and independence. So I don't see this, we shouldn't pay attention to Ukraine because there is Belarus. I don't see it as either or. We should have capacity to basically attend to both, because the needs and priorities in Ukraine and Belarus are very, very different. And perhaps for the EU, you may not have this problem in the US, but for us, this rhetoric of the Eastern Partnership, which basically labels six different countries with the same umbrella, has really sort of made us a bit sort of mask the differences as such. So Belarus and Ukraine are at different points for a variety of reasons. But what is important to emphasize for us is that we are talking about the 30th anniversary of the collapse of the USSR. Anniversary or whatever we want to call it, as expressing from the Kremlin, it would be called very differently that, for example, in Ukraine. The fact is that we still have a shadow of the Iron Curtain in Europe. And it's important to talk about the very slow disintegration and long-term ramifications of the way that the Soviet Union collapsed. And what we are dealing with, security, democracy, state, borders, integration, this is basically a fallout from the collapse of the USSR, and it's still unfinished business. So basically either focusing on Ukraine or Belarus is, we need to be able to deal with the post-Soviet space as a whole, including Russia.
Thank you, Kataryna. Now I'd like to come back to you, Stanislav, vis-a-vis Russia's growing footprint in Belarus. Do you think there's a possibility that there can be an increasing anti-Russian sentiment in the country? I mean, if Russia goes too far in terms of expanding its influence, you know, politically and in economic terms, but also militarily. I mean, when we look back to the to Armenia, for example, you know, after Nikol Pashinyan came into power, I mean, the Russians were very careful not to you know, involve themselves too much, even though they weren't a big fan of Nikol Pashinyan, simply because they didn't want to bring a further anti-Russian sentiment into the neighborhood. I mean, is there a possibility that we could have a bigger wave of anti-Russian sentiment coming out of Belarus? I mean, Belarus has been, you know, historically friendly to the Russians, but could this change? And what would be the impact of this?
Well, Amanda, I think it's already changing, maybe not dramatically, but still, you know, when we speak about the protesters, those who took to the streets of Minsk and other Belarusian cities, protesting against the Lukashenko regime and the rigged elections, etc., etc. You know, their mottos, their slogans, they were never anti-Russian, and they were not about foreign policy in any considerable way. There were very much domestic protests, demanding change, demanding freedom, demanding free elections, etc., etc. And a lot of people who were considered and who were and who still are pro-Russian, Russian speaking, etc., etc., they took part in these protests. You know, there is a change. There is a sea change, I would say, in Belarusian politics, because for almost 30 years, the Belarusian civil society or political like sphere, whatever that means in the case of Belarus, was perceived, at least from Russia, as divided into two uneven groups, a small group of anti-Russian, pro-Western, Belarusian-speaking opposition figures, a small group, half of them living abroad for decades, like a marginal group, and the vast majority of Russian-speaking, pro-Russian, and at the same time pro-Lukashenko, like Belarusians. And this, like, distribution, I think, changed in the year 2020, because those who protested and who still protest in one way or another against Lukashenko, they are not protesting based on his, like, views on Russia or the West. They are protesting him because protesting against him because, well, he's not the guy they voted for, and he's not the guy who is whom they want to see as the leader of Belarus for another 26 years. And in this case, the position of Russia of, let's say, unconditional support to Lukashenko, of course, alienated to, in one way or another, some of these pro-Russian, Russian-speaking, et cetera, majority of Belarusians. I cannot say that all of them turned to the West and condemned Russia. They understand that Russia is not a democracy, and it would be like weird to assume that Moscow would support pro-democracy protests in Belarus or elsewhere in the world. So it was a pipe dream by some commentators who claim that Russia was and still is pushing Lukashenko towards like democratization, towards a meaningful change in a constitution, et cetera, et cetera. Why on earth would Moscow want like democratic change in Belarus? And the point is that those protesters, they dislike Lukashenko for the very same reasons that the Russian opposition dislikes President Putin, for the very same reasons. And so the civil society in Russia and the civil society in Belarus, I think they understand each other quite perfectly. Maybe it's for the first time in 30 years, like the civil societies of both countries like recognized each other and felt real sympathy towards each other. And I want to add a grain of skepticism towards this concept that Belarus has changed for good and the Belarusian nation has been born in 2020 and life will never be the same. Well, I'm old enough to remember the mass protests in Moscow and St. Petersburg and elsewhere in Russia in 2011 and 2012 following the supposedly rigged elections of the Russian parliament. There were great amounts of people on the streets of different political persuasions or apolitical people as well. A lot of people from the previous governments, a lot of people from mass media, et cetera, took to the streets to demand change, democracy, et cetera, and a lot of people believed in Russia and the West that Russia has changed for good. And if we compare Russia of 2011 to Russia of 2021, well, I cannot say that we live in a freer society than we lived like 10 years ago at the height of these Russian protests. Of course, all parallels are flawed, but still I cannot help like drawing this parallel. Maybe the Belarusian situation is different, but still just I see it. And on the issue of sanctions, I want to just to once again to add a grain of skepticism here. Maybe the colleagues will inform me, but I'm not sure I know of any situation in these in which sanctions led to a regime change. I cannot think of any country of any situation in which sanctions like led to regime change. You mentioned some of us mentioned Cuba, like who's been under sanctions for I don't know 50 years, 60. I'm not sure. And one more thing, the last thing about the leaderless resistance in Belarus and whether or not it's the key problem in the decline of protests and the leaderless resistance, or let's say the failure of protest leadership. I think the main problem is not like the absence of leader or the like the quality of Tikhanovskaya per se. I think the main point in the main reason of this decline in protest activity is that the price of participation is getting higher and higher. And at the same time, the victory is not at hand. So you can go on taken to the streets in thousands, then in hundreds, then in dozens, and you will put to jail, all you will fired from your work, all you will you'll be expelled from your like university, etc., etc. So the price is high, but the outcome is low, and it's not about the change in the country's like life, but it's about the change in your personal life and the change in a negative direction.
There's just a comment here from Nicholas White saying that sanctions were an important part of regime change story in South Africa and Serbia, which I think is true. But I mean, we all know that sanctions aren't a policy in themselves. I mean, there needs to be something else there. But I mean, in these cases, they definitely played an important role. But just staying with you a minute, Stanislav. Coming back to the relationship between the EU and Russia, which we all know is, you know, and the EU and the Russia and the United States as well. I mean, it's full of problems, let's say. I don't think it's ever been worse than it is today. Do you see that, you know, if Russia continues to, let's say, enlarge its role in Belarus, this can eventually become a huge obstacle as well, or another problem in this relationship?
Well, I'm not sure it's the biggest problem the Russia-EU relations face. So in this case, I mean, there is a wide acceptance, at least what I see, that Belarus is still Russia's ally, and Russia defends its ally by all means it sees fit, including by accepting Lukashenko as the legitimate leader, including by strengthening the ties between security services, because once again, it's about securitization. After all, it's about security. And in a couple of months ago, there were joint military drills, Russian-Belarusian military drills in the territory of Belarus. So in this, by all this, Russia shows the EU, the West, NATO, et cetera, that it will not tolerate any interference in this country, because Russia believes it has an obligation to defend its ally or to defend its president. Because once again, Russia is quite suspicious of civil society, the Russian government is quite suspicious of civil society, especially protest civil society, both domestically and in Belarus and elsewhere. So once again, it's not about like civil society. It's not about making Russia more acceptable for the protesters, or it's not about projecting the image of Russia as a more free society than Belarus under Lukashenko. It's all about, you know, Russia and the global West, in which case no civil society, no elections, all of this is unimportant.
Now I have a question here from Jerome Legrand. Who's asking again a question about Russia. Is there a risk that Russia will open a military base in Belarus against Russian support to the Lukashenko regime? Is that possible?
Well, it's possible technically.
I think that's for you, Stanislav.
Technically, of course, it's possible. There is but the obstacle is Lukashenko himself. Of course, everybody understands, I hope, that the West or NATO doesn't want to invade Russia, including through Belarus, with tanks and armies and whatnot. But at the same time, this base would be a symbolic gesture by Lukashenko, bolstering or proving his loyalty or his alliance to Russia. But he doesn't make this move. So it's not that Russia doesn't want to have this symbolic military base. It's about Lukashenko wanting to remain as neutral as possible. Maybe it sounds a bit ridiculous, but at least as sovereign as possible and as distant as possible from Moscow in the given circumstances.
Okay, thank you. I want to encourage the audience to put their questions. We still have about 20 minutes left. Now I'm going to come back to you, Yauheni, because I can see you have your hand up. So if you have a question to one of the panelists, or you wanted to comment on something, because otherwise I would like to focus a bit on the regional security implications of the changing, let's say, geostrategic face of Belarus.
Well, this issue is the central one I'm working on, so I'm particularly interested in that. Let me quickly just make a few comments. I mean, so many things have been said which are important. I want to comment, but I'll be short. So, on the base, which is related, on the military base issue, which is related to regional security, I mean, I agree with what Stanislav said, but I just wanted to add that we need to understand that under these present circumstances, the issue is gradually becoming structural. In other words, if Lukashenko has room to maneuver to make sure that he says no to Putin's and Russia's wishes as to the base without any major political repercussions for him, he will. But as his room for maneuver is shrinking, it might at some point become impossible to say no. And we simply need to understand this is the physics of this. But now very quickly on a few very practical things. I don't want to enter into this discussion with Melinda regarding literalist, not literalist. In the end, I don't think it makes much sense to discuss it here, and it's becoming an issue of taste. But it does have some practical implications, which we need to keep in mind. First of all, if this is a situation where we are now having Svetlana Tikhanovskaya as the leader, then this is a change of the situation. Because if you remember, right from the beginning, Tikhanovskaya and her team were themselves saying that they're not the leaders, that this is the protest which doesn't need their orders. And that was conceptually important because it gave us a clear idea about how the whole protest was functioning. That was a wrong idea about the possibilities of the protest to prevail over a consolidated authoritarian regime, which is now clear. But if now Svetlana Tikhanovskaya claims this leadership, then at least for the international community and specifically for the West, it is important to understand the practical implication. If this is a leader who keeps making mistakes and who is unable to deal with two clear factors which predetermine the prospects of the protest. And those two aspects are as follows. First of all, the state apparatus, including the Siloviki, and secondly, Russia. So if someone who claims leadership on behalf of the protest is unable to deal with these two major factors, then perhaps the very idea of forcing Lukashenko to have a dialogue with Tikhanovskaya doesn't make sense in the end. And then all this has to be reevaluated. So I'm just trying to stress the methodological, if you will, side of this whole story. Secondly, again, on the methodological side, I think we need to be aware, and people in the West need to be aware, that the longer we are in this situation where the Lukashenko regime continues to cling to power by closing everything, the more this disconnect between the reality on the ground and what people in the West think is growing. And you just need to keep that in mind, because otherwise mistakes will be inevitable. And we just lived through this back 10 years ago after the previous crackdown. And lastly, on sanctions, again, it's a separate long discussion, but I simply don't see how this whole sanctioning can deliver. We've already seen like half a year of sanctions and not a single of the official goals for why sanctions have been introduced have not only been resolved, but even any progress has been made. There are three criteria which the West and the EU in particular usually name for why they introduce sanctions. First of all, to deter repressive behavior. Secondly, to force the incumbent regime into concessions on the already made repressive decisions, including political prisoners. And lastly, to force the regime into negotiations with the opponents. If you track developments on the three of them, you see you don't only see the progress, but you see that a regress has taken place. And unfortunately, again, we can discuss it in further detail. Unfortunately, I don't just see the mechanics of how the West, with very, very limited leverage vis-a-vis Belarus, can achieve its goals.
Amanda, do you mind if I jump in?
Yeah, go ahead, Melinda.
I promise to be fast. Thanks for those responses, Yevgeny. It's interesting to go back and forth. This is partly a response to Stanislav too. So on sanctions, I agree with you that the West has little leverage in Belarus. That's why this problem set is so difficult. Sanctions are meant to change behavior. The sanctions that the West has put on Belarus are weak. If we're serious about supporting Belarus and the democratic movement there, we need to massively increase our sanctions. And there are options. We have to have the courage to do it. And Washington hasn't had enough courage. We have a new president, now is the time. So I don't accept the argument that it won't work. We haven't done it correctly is my argument. On Russia, Stanislav, I think that you make a somewhat persuasive point about 2011 in Russia, that just because there's thousands of people who come out and there's massive hopes, it didn't change anything. It did change something though. Yes, Vladimir Putin has gotten worse. The regime has gotten more repressive, but it did something super important. It gave birth to a vibrant opposition movement. It gave birth to Navalny and all the opposition work that's been done since then. I think we forget that these getting rid of authoritarians is not easy, right? This is about changing power structures. That's really, really hard. I don't think that the democratic movement in Belarus is going to change the power structure this time, but they will eventually. There's no going back.
So Melinda, so you believe that strong sanctions would change the situation in the country? Is that what you're saying? I mean, why do you believe that's the case?
That's one of the only options that the West has. I agree, I think Kataryna, or you said it, Amanda, that sanctions are not a policy. And the West, in my crowd, loves sanctions, but it has to be thought through. There's a number of things we have to do at the same time. Just throwing more sanctions on Belarus and on Lukashenko's money men is insufficient. We can do better.
Okay, I have a couple of questions here from Roxana Christescu from CMI. The first question is that she's asking, the fact that, you know, Belarus has, as we've already discussed, you know, disappeared from the headlines, you know, what impact has this had on regional dynamics? And the second question is related to the role of China. I mean, is China playing any role in Belarus or the neighborhood that can impact on, you know, on the current dynamic in the country? I mean, what is the role of China, if any? Okay. Who would like to elaborate on those excellent questions?
Well, I can begin with China, if it's, that's okay. I think China has been absent from the media headlines when it comes to Belarus. And on that basis, a lot of people here in Belarus, but also analysts looking at Belarus, concluded that China was, you know, somehow leaning towards non-supporting Lukashenko or something like this. No, I don't find any empirical evidence of that. And from what I know, a bit of inside of things as well, I mean, the dialogue with China continues as it was, obviously. And by the way, China, I think, was the first country to congratulate Lukashenko on his victory. So it tells you a little bit about the overall approach. But at the same time, it is crystal clear that what happens between Belarus and the EU in the context of the political crisis in Belarus is not of particular interest alike into China. Because after 2014, China was indeed looking at Belarus as this potential linkage between some of its projects, including as part of the BRI ideas. And we have a huge Chinese-Belarusian industrial park here in Belarus. And obviously the interest was not just to get access to the Eurasian Economic Union through Belarus. Actually, geographically, China does not need that. It's easier to do that via Russia, since Russia is in any way the destination market for the Eurasian Economic Union. But it was also interested in having potentially Belarus as this ground from which products could be exported to the EU. And for that matter, both the Belarusians and the Chinese were quite active in trying to attract EU shareholders and participants in this Belarusian-Chinese industrial park, which in a way worked because, for instance, some Germans were there, which looked promising. Now that we have these kind of political problems and we still remain, I mean, Belarus still remains without any framework agreement with the EU, this is not particularly of practical value to China. So it might be concerning to them. But I think overall the Chinese position is as strategic as it always is. They are just waiting and trying to see and understand where things are going to develop.
Amanda, sorry, I can't believe I made the same mistake again. The second question, the impact on the regional dynamics of, you know, Belarus disappearing a bit from the international agenda. I mean, has there been a significant impact? Maybe Kataryna, would you like to take that?
Thank you very much. I'll just come back to reiterate basically the point made by Yauheni that China is very pragmatic and it's certainly not going to push for any democratization, but it can work with either democratic or authoritarian leaders, depending on the needs. So China is not really a game changer here. It is insofar as Lukashenko's increased reliance on Moscow for economic resources means that China plays a lesser role, if anything, vis-a-vis Russia as in terms of economic support. So it's more sort of reliance on Moscow rather than Beijing. In terms of regional dynamic, that's very, very interesting. For me, I take a longer term view because I see Belarus now in the context of the Georgian-Russian war of 2008, and then basically the so-called Ukraine conflict, which is effectively, you know, Russia-Ukraine proxy war. And from that point of view, Belarus does matter, because the role of the West, and especially the EU, sends a powerful signal that basically the EU does not mind whatever happens on its eastern border. And the regional dynamic is that the EU promises three things: democracy, modernization, and security. And we know from the Eastern Partnership countries, those three dimensions are in much demand. And across the region, basically, the EU is perceived as a democracy promoter, and yet, here is Belarus, where is the EU? So for me, on security, we are where we are with the EU especially, but when it comes to modernization and democracy, the EU has been on high moral grounds. And there's a real risk of basically this attrition or sort of decline in the standing of the EU across the region. So for me, the long-term consequences, we know, for example, that countries like Azerbaijan, a very neatly consolidated authoritarian regime, got a very strong message from the Georgian-Russian war that the West is weak. We can do what we want, and the only sort of player really is Russia. So Azeri officials mentioned officially, basically over dinners, that this is, they got the message. I'm afraid how many more messages will we need, especially now, the latest addition of Belarus, before we can still talk about a coherent and effective foreign policy of the West towards the region.
But just on that point, I mean, I want to come bring Ukraine into the question here, because clearly what happens in Belarus is crucial for Ukraine, and the changing regional security dynamic can have a massive impact on Ukraine. I mean, in the event that this military base was opened in Belarus, I mean, I'm guessing if President Putin really wants a military base there, I don't think there'll be that much Mr. Lukashenko can do about it if Putin is his only ally. What would be the implications there? I mean, not just for Ukraine. I mean, they would be surrounded, I mean, really surrounded more than they are now by Russia. But for NATO as well in that region, and shouldn't we already be thinking or forward thinking about how to push back against that? I think sometimes in the West we're too much, you know, reactive instead of being proactive.
Yes, this is, I'll come back on this if it is okay with you, Amanda. This is of great concern. My perception is perhaps that for Mr. Lukashenko, any military, Russian military base on the Belarusian territory would be above all a domestic threat, basically, of some kind of a political change. So from that point of view, I think they'll be resistant for the regime sort of survival reasons and a threat rather than because of concern vis-a-vis Ukraine. Ukraine is already surrounded so much by Russia and so much more weakened. So this has been already, there is a consensus in Ukraine that the strategy of Ukraine has to be raise the costs of any intervention, human and financial and international cost of any potential intervention. Obviously, Belarus would make it, you know, a military base in Ukraine, in Belarus, would make it even more difficult and the costs higher for Ukraine. But I don't think it would change the resolve. It would actually make the situation dire, but Ukraine still would not surrender. That's my understanding of the situation. But we have to say that Belarus and Lukashenko has resisted, for example, signing, basically backing the Kremlin on Ukraine on various issues. So this is an interesting litmus test for us to see to what extent a military base which could be used against Ukraine, that would really tell us where Lukashenko is in terms of retaining that autonomy and wriggle room vis-a-vis Moscow. And that would be perhaps one area to watch, because that autonomy and ability to resist demands from Moscow on the wider regional policy may have been eliminated already.
Thank you. I think, Yauheni, you wanted to respond on the sanctions, but as we only have 3 minutes, I would like all of you to wrap up with, you know, an answer to this question. I mean, what would be your predictions as to where Belarus is going to be, let's say, in the next 6 to 8 months? Where do you think the country will be at? And what should the West be doing? This question is obviously not to you, Stanislav, but to the others. What could the West be doing to help Belarus the most in the next few months? And Stanislav, to you, you know, what do you think how the Russian policy will develop in the next 6 months? So let's start with you, Yauheni, then we'll go around.
Sanctions very quickly. Again, it's a very separate discussion. I just call on everyone to be really attentive to details and professional about this discussion rather than just follow emotions. And, the only thing I'll say, because we heard from a couple of speakers that the EU and the West needs to introduce more sanctions. And, you know, in this discussion, it's always about more and more and more because it gets emotional and it gets political. And we just don't accept the fact that there is no mechanics through which sanctions can deliver. There is no internal group. That is connected to my argument about the leadership issue. There is no mechanics through which external impulse, that is sanctions, can now be transformed into another major internal impulse for more progress. They cannot even reach the level of what we had last year just because of sanctions. And secondly, you know, surprise, surprise, Russia is there, and we already discussed it. So the two major issues make the mechanics of transferring the external impulse of sanctions and the internal political impulse impossible. Because, and that's why the very simple answer to this simple proposition that more sanctions are in order is that, you know, if we continue raising the sanctions, unfortunately, I don't have any other predictions for you, but that Belarus, not only Russia will be the only game in town, it is already the only game in town. And of course, the old maxim will work, my way a highway, and the highway will lead to Moscow. And the simple outcome will be that Belarus will become a part of Russia, if not, you know, as a state, but completely dominated to it with zero room for maneuver. And you just need to realize that and to prepare yourself for this outcome. But then if we make predictions, certainly it's difficult because not only the internal dynamic is so turbulent and uncertain, but also the external pressures are uncertain and unknown. And I need to stress it once again, we are living through a period of a transformation in the international system, and many things which we knew how they worked in the past perhaps will not work the same way right now. And that will impact the situation in Belarus. But I think what we are, the baseline scenario which we are set for is Lukashenko remains where he is, and he will be transforming the political system in the country. The constitutional reform is already being prepared, but unfortunately, what he is going to impose on society is not going to be to the liking of the protesters and all of us discussing it here. So we also need to be prepared for that. This is the result of this head-on collision with the authoritarian regime.
Thank you, Yauheni. Kataryna?
Thank you, Yauheni. You really are an antidote to various sort of idealistic proclamations from the Belarusian opposition. So quite a sort of antidote. It's difficult to disagree. We are talking about we need basically a longer term strategy to weaken the regime, and there are various ways, not least talking about this information war, which we have support for. Humanitarian assistance, political strategy, weakening the regime in terms of its informational space, especially when it comes to people, less educated people outside Minsk. So it's very much, someone from the US mentioned that we are missing, and I would never expect to hear this, to have more sort of people with what they remember what was in the 1980s rather than now, because we tend to be too idealistic and too optimistic. And Belarus does require a longer term strategy and very complex and strategic patience. And the issue is it may be that Lukashenko falls under a bus. We need to be prepared for strategic surprises. So this, what I call for capacity and thinking on Belarus, to be able to engage, but also to understand and respond. The fact that what Yevheny says, Belarus may not change, doesn't mean that we don't have to think how and when things are going to change. Thank you.
Thank you. Your prediction?
Belarus has changed. That's the reality. We don't know which way it's going to go. I think Yevgeny is probably right that Lukashenko will stay in power for the next 6 to 8 months. I don't see an obvious off-ramp. The one thing, though, that gives me pause about his remarks is he seems to think that the Belarusian people don't have a vote. The Belarusian people get to decide the outcome of their country. Yes, Russia is strong and it has enormous leverage there. I understand that. But the Belarusian people ultimately decide which way their country is going to go in. And they are in charge, not Moscow.
Stanislav.
Well, if I were a Kremlin spin doctor, I would recommend a more balanced approach to Belarus. And I would recommend to start talk about with the members of the civil society, opposition, political leaders, and others. But I'm a realist, and I know that it will not happen, at least in 6 or 8 months, because the biggest secret of Russia's foreign policy is that Russia never really supports opposition in this or that country. It either supports the current regime, doesn't matter how it came to power, what methods employs in dealing with the internal situation. So it's either it either supports the current regime or it's neutral towards the current regime, just like in the case of Armenia. The Kremlin doesn't like the current Armenian president, but still it's not against him. So of course I agree with my colleagues that in the end all the world will become more democratic than it is now, but I'm not sure it will happen in 6 to 8 months.
Okay, I would like to thank all of you for joining us today for this discussion. I think it was really interesting. We exchanged ideas and initiatives on many different topics. I agree that, you know, change is inevitable. You know, you don't stand still. I mean, Belarus has changed so much, and I'm sure it will continue to change in the future. And I really wish that the population, the people of Belarus, will have a more democratic and freer future. I really hope that Russia doesn't end up being the only game in town, because this would be a tragedy for the country. But this also depends as well on the, you know, on the ongoing support and focus that comes from, you know, the West, and this needs to continue. We need to continue to support the Belarusian people. At EPC, we will be continuing to follow developments in Belarus over the next months and possibly years. So thank you again for joining us today to our excellent speakers. And also thank you very much to the audience. And I wish you a very good afternoon and evening.